Awesome. So my name is Lakshmi. I'm a professor at NYU. And today I'll be talking about something called causal evidence extraction of famine. And this is joint work with Anand Balashankar, who is my PhD student sitting over there, and Sam Freiberger at the World Bank. And if you have any very difficult questions, I'll pose it to Anand, and any easy questions, I'll take it. So there is a five-level classification of famine, starting from minimal stress, crisis, emergency, going all the way to full-blown famine, as you might have learned from Nadia's talk. Now, the question here is, can we use natural language processing and machine learning to characterize or predict this level using news data? Okay? And the reason I want to use the word causal evidence is, rather than throwing statistics at the problem, I'm actually going to throw English at the problem. Okay? So reporters write news, right? And reporters have an inherent structure on how they write news, okay? So the reason that every NGO and humanitarian organization has pointed out that famine is man-made is that it is caused by the war. This is a random statement in BBC. Whether you agree with it or not, it was written by a reporter at some particular point in time, right? Now, the key point here is there is a word famine that's appearing. There is a word cost that's appearing. There's a word called war appearing, right? And this is a random statement, okay? Now, if I can extract all these types of causal statements across 25 years, across 30 countries, can I understand what causes famine? That's the journey we are kind of embarking on, okay? So what we did was we took Factiva data, and Dow Jones data, and we were able to write parsers of very simple English statements which have a causal nature to it, right? And thanks to years of research on natural language processing, semantic frame parsing, which has been done even 20 years ago, right, provides a simple framework to extract these causation sentences. Okay. Now I can look at these sentences for each country and look at what was the cost, what was the effect. And these are not just due to the word cost, right? These could be due to, because of. I mean, there are, so the causation frame takes English grammar into construction and derives these cost, effect, word embedding clusters. Then there is all these work on machine learning, especially to embed words in high-dimensional space, and you can cluster words that kind of look alike or group alike, right? So you can look at this type of reasoning at a clustering level, okay? So that's the overall approach we started with. Then I'm going to further build upon it. So we took articles across 15 states, going across 15 fragile states, going across 30 years of news. And we started parsing these causal statements. And then we started condensing the graph into something that we can understand. And then we started understanding different types of countries based on these causal statements, right? From these causal statements, I'll get into prediction towards the end of my talk. But I just wanted to give you the overall scope. Now, if you take a country like Mali, for example, it's not easy to get news articles. Okay. Even if you're doing across 30 years, the data can be very sparse. Okay. So one thing I do want to forewarn is that we are dealing with very highly sparse data, and then we are trying to look for signatures in these sparse data. Right. With that in mind, so there are several ways of classifying countries which are affected by famine at some point, okay? Based on a particular classification of words, we got to the opinion that Tanzania and Kenya have an interesting loop of famine, which is very closely related to drought. Okay, and this can be seen, the red nodes on the left are causation words associated with the effect being famine. The green nodes on the right are effect words with the causation word being famine. Okay, so I fixate famine as a word to be either a cause or an effect, and I'm just looking at linguistic words that appear on the left and linguistic words on the right. And some of these words may not even make sense, right? You might see the word Mugabe appearing in Zimbabwe, right? So you need to interpret some of these words in each country's context, and I'm giving you sort of a raw output of one such parser rather than pre-filtering the output, okay? And if you see the word UNK, it means unknown, okay? Now, this is famine drought with respect to Tanzania, Rwanda, and Kenya. If you look at South Sudan and Afghanistan, what you'll see is a very interesting loop between famine and conflict. How conflict influences famine and how famine influences conflict. Okay? And these are very nicely separated by a few months. So you'll see an article where conflict has influenced famine in January, and you might see an article where famine has influenced conflict in March or April, right? So this, the same thing now appears for South Sudan, Somalia, Yemen, and Afghanistan, which kind of matches with some of the things that you were mentioning about South Sudan and Somalia in the same vein. If you look at Zimbabwe, Ethiopia, and Yemen, there's a lot of political, economic factors going on. So especially in the context of Yemen, you can also see the word blockade, which actually never appeared in other countries. You can see the word food aid coming in as effect. So this is in the context of Zimbabwe, Ethiopia, and Yemen. And if you look at other countries, like Zambia, the word climate change starts to appear. Okay? And if you look at Niger, the word pests and disease start to appear. So you get a classification of countries across different dimensions. So if you put this all in a map, you would see a particular area in blue and green which have conflict and political instabilities. You'll see a set of red and yellow clusters, orange clusters, which are related to drought and climate change related factors. And you have one case which is related to pests and disease. So this is across the fragile states that we ran parts of the analysis. Okay. So now, what do we do with this? You can start to look at temporal variations of these causes with the fused data. Okay. So a dot across a line means that that word is appearing. And the blue curve is actually the fuse score data. Now, the fuse score data only starts around 2009, 2010. And I'm giving you word counts from 1993. Okay? So you'll see the blue curve only appearing to the right side because that data is only available for the last 10 years. Okay? So what you can see is that when you see certain spikes in the famine, and this is in the 0 to 5 scale, which is in the across the five gradients of what is famine as measured by fuse. And so when you see specific spikes, you can also see which are the types of words that are pre-occurring and post-occurring. Okay? So this is just a word plot, and you could do the same temporal variations for FX. And you can actually come up with specific outcomes on a country-by-country basis on the connection between these effects and conflict, political stabilities, and so on. Okay? So building upon this even further, so one thing you need to note is that the data can be really sparse for specific countries. So this is an example where in Rwanda and Yemen, we had very little data going before. So for example, in Yemen, until 2015, there was almost no data. And suddenly, after 2015, like the number of articles talking about this has exploded. Okay? Now, let me skip this. Apart from this data, you can also take an additional data, like the Uppsala conflict data, and we were able to find that death counts as appeared, as published by Uppsala, has an interesting signal to predict the upswing of famine. And we've been able to find that across a few countries. So I have 5 more minutes, and I'll be done before that. So now, taking a sidestep back, as another related experiment using the same data, we were able to show that if you take the Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, MERS disease, you actually have very little actual data about MERS in terms of its availability and spread and so on, right? We were able to take news as an augmented signal and take original data on MERS, and we could reconstruct the full spread of MERS country by country with much lower error than just using a standard disease model or just using news alone. So what you need to note is that SIR is a standard disease model of MERS, and GDELT is a news data set, right? So if you're able to combine SIR with GDELT, we're able to reduce the residual error by almost a factor 3 than just using an SIR model, or by a factor 2 just by using news data. So the point is, if you have a model of how famine is, if you can model the spread of famine, then news as an augmentation data source helps you reconstruct the data a lot better. So this is an example where we were able to do such a reconstruction. Now, putting all these things together, what we did was, this is all this debate about predictive causality and true causality. Now I'm jumping into the statistics work, okay? So what we did was, we took every word in the English dictionary, and we said, oh, maybe this word can influence famine, this word can influence famine. So we started taking pairs of words and started running predictive causality tests as measurable by Granger causality. Okay, so we constructed a million cross million Granger causality graph. Now, famine just happens to be one node in this graph, so I could actually look for words that might relate to famine, right? So there's a bunch of math, let me skip that. Going to the same famine data, what we were able to show was some of the signals that we were able to extract country by country had very strong Granger causality with famine. So we can put the time lag to which it can actually impact. So if I know that these signals are impacting, I can exactly use these signals to potentially predict famine. Okay? And so 0.0, anything above 0.05 is actually a very significant Granger causal in terms of being a useful variable for predictive models. Now, we did this for onion prices in India a while ago. And if I had to, the things in yellow look not so readable, but if I had to summarize 15 years of onion price fluctuations in India, the most important factor that influenced onion prices fluctuations was strikes. The second most important factor was price rise of fuel and transportation. The third most was festivals and celebrations like Diwali and Ramzan. The fourth most was natural disasters. So natural disasters is actually a much lesser variable than strikes. Okay? And then came government policies and other political events. So these are the 6 critical factors that affected onion price fluctuations, where onion fluctuates by a factor 3 within 2 weeks in India. And it's part of most Indian dishes, so it's the most sensitive vegetable. And we were able to plug these factors into neural net models. I want you to just focus on these two numbers, 0.0823 and 70.765. So So using these variables in a neural net, we were able to predict an up spike or a down spike in onions with 82% precision, 76% recall. So price of an onion is going to suddenly shoot up, and we're able to capture that signal with very high precision and recall using news. And we believe the same thing can hold for famine as well. So let me stop here, and there is a lot more work to do in expanding this to being able to do predictive models, and we are continuing to interact with the World Bank teams to expand this scope of work. So I'll take questions at the very end. Thanks.